So, this is Brad Pitt playing a genius in the movie Big Short. And take a listen to what he's about to say.
You guys should start your own garden. What you gotta do is get your soil off petrochemicals. I used wood ash and urine, help restore the soil, creates ammonium nitrate. Seeds are gonna be the new currency.
So I wanted to understand why he said that and if there's any truth to it. The idea doesn't sound strange to me at all. In fact, Aztecs and Mayans, they used cocoa seeds as means of currency in the past. And it's no wonder, because everywhere you see a cradle of a civilization, planting seeds was at the heart of it. And this happens because humanity only grows if it works together, and it only survives working together if there's enough food, shelter, raw materials for everybody. And seeds provide all of those. And just a quick note, before I researched this topic, I thought seeds were everywhere, that you just had to collect, plant, and then repeat the process for infinite seeds. But I was wrong. The seed world is complicated. For instance, if I plant a kernel from this cob, I can get sued by Bayer. By the end of this video, we'll have covered how valuable seeds are becoming, and why this watermelon has none inside it. And I'll bet that you'll also be surprised to find out that most of the commercial seeds available are actually intellectual property, and it is owned by an oligopoly that is slowly becoming the owners of our food chain. This topic will lead us on a journey for which there is no return. You've been warned. So, if seeds are going to become the new currency, they need to abide by the laws of supply and demand. And that's what we'll focus on today, their scarcity and their perceived value. So, are seeds becoming more scarce? If you're like me, it's even hard to imagine seeds as scarce. We don't see farmers complaining, and we can easily find them in supermarkets. Heck, they're even inside the food we eat. And that's true. In fact, most countries even have their own seed vaults to catalog and protect their local varieties. There's even a global seed vault in Norway that has collected and stored over 1 million varieties from all around the world. They call it the Doomsday Vault. Apparently, the place is prepared to resist all types of natural and man-made disasters. And as a side note, despite being created only in 2008, it has already been helpful in restoring the biodiversity in Syria, whose seed vault was compromised by the ongoing civil war. So there's an abundant variety of seeds, and in addition, seeds multiply really quickly. One kernel takes about 4 months to grow into an ear, which will give you in turn around 600 kernels. Plant those and you'll have over 300,000 kernels. Repeat the process and you'll reach millions. So why am I talking about scarcity? The issue here is that with the increased industrialization, farmers worldwide have been abandoning their local varieties to focus on crops that are more profitable and reliable. Since the 1900s, 75% of the plant genetic diversity has been lost, and today, rice, maize and wheat account for 60% of the world's caloric intake. Variety is being narrowed down, in favor of genetically uniform but profitable species. We now cultivate only about 150 out of an estimated 30,000 edible plant species worldwide, with only 30 plant species comprising the vast majority of our diets. So okay, the variety is getting reduced. But I don't need variety, as long as I can access the basic staples like corn, right? Well, there's an additional problem, and that is that we're slowly losing the rights to plant those seeds. Life is becoming intellectual property owned by corporations. They can now patent seeds, animals, even strings of DNA. The ethics behind this is a whole nother video. If you're interested in discussing this, please leave me a comment below. Today, we'll focus on plants. Why are we patenting them? And why is that even legal? Shouldn't evolution and biodiversity be exempt from intellectual property? The thing is, these plants are not a product of evolution, they are a result of engineering. Companies cannot patent a plant variety, like a pepper, but they can patent characteristics of the plant, like how spicy they made them, as well as the process to develop the seed. The agricultural industry argues that research and development is expensive, and so being guaranteed exclusive rights to the profits of what they create is the biggest incentive to innovate. And from the data that we have, intellectual property actually drives innovation. They not only make the market more competitive, but they also create tools to deal with the increasing environmental challenges, such as the climate, pests, weeds. But how did it come to this? Let's dive really quickly through the history of plant patenting in the US and what it means for our future. Up until the 20th century, patent protection didn't apply to plants. Farmers were allowed to grow and share seeds, and the US Agricultural Division would even invest 1/3 of its budget in collecting and distributing seeds to farmers for free. In 1883, the American Seed Trade Association was created, and by 1924, it successfully lobbied the Congress to terminate the free seed distribution program. Seeds could now become a profitable business. 1930 was when it all began. The US Plant Patent Act was signed, and it became possible to patent a sexually reproduced plant stock. Back then, most protection went for roses, who made up more than half of the patents emitted. The 30s and 40s were when tractors started substituting horses, and commercial fertilizers developed during World War II became widespread in agriculture. Up until this time, all plants were what we consider today heirlooms. So heirlooms haven't changed since the 50s. They are always open pollinated and will produce plants that are roughly identical to their parents. No heirloom is patented because they were not man-made. They belong to all of us. Then in the 50s, hybrids started to boom. An hybrid is the result of a crossing between two different species within the same plant. Generally, breeders find two varieties that have desirable traits and then join them into one plant by mixing their pollen. For instance, to create seedless watermelons, like we saw in the beginning, breeding scientists grow two different varieties of watermelons, both bearing seeds. And then, they mix the pollen of their flowers in order to create this hybrid that bears no seeds. And this process has to constantly be repeated, because, well, they have no seeds, they cannot be planted again. And keep in mind that this is not the only way of creating seedless fruits and vegetables, there are other methods. If you want to know more about this process, check the video below. So back to hybrids. They are much more than just seedless varieties. They are the origin of many of the fruits and vegetables that we regularly eat today. And they generally originate from a long and hard process of experimentation, where breeders try to achieve the desired characteristics of the parent plants, and this makes them more commercially interesting. In the 1960s, 99% of all corn grown in the US were hybrids. The thing is that if a hybrid is a first generation, the next generation will probably look very different from the plant they originally came from, and may sometimes be sterile. So when farmers bought these seeds, they had agreed to not regrow what they had just planted, so they had to rely on plant breeders to sell them the same seeds every year. Still, they grew hybrids because it gave them a higher yield from the crops, which is more profitable than being self-sufficient but having to rely on lower yield open pollinated corn. And because reaching the desired and consistent results with hybrids is hard, the company started demanding intellectual protection for what they create. Then, in the 1970s, the Plant Variety Protection Act was introduced, and it allowed breeders to protect their hybrid creations and thus incentivize innovation. It was now allowed to protect sexually produced plant varieties. Initially, there were several exceptions. Farmers and breeders could still use each other's varieties, develop their own, and use hybrid seeds. This gave rise to thousands of varieties that we still have today. But by 1994, most of the protection exemptions had fallen, and now the seeds available in the market were commercial products. This was about the time when GMOs started to become widespread. These are genetically engineered plants created by companies like Monsanto and DuPont. Roughly speaking, the way they create them is by searching for the traits that they want in other species of plants and even in animals, and then transferring that DNA string to their target organism. These traits are mostly herbicide tolerance and insect resistance. And just to dissolve some myth, 90% of the crops grown in the US that are GMO are not for direct human consumption. They are corn and soybean used to feed animals and cotton for industrial use. You are in fact much more likely to find GMOs in processed foods that use canola oil, sugar beets and cornstarch than you are to find them in supermarkets. So if you're not a farmer, your chances of coming across a GMO seed are very slim. The distribution of these seeds are rigorously controlled by the companies who made them and are sold exclusively to farmers via tightly controlled contracts. Farmers are not allowed to reuse the seeds they grow nor give them to other farmers. Even random cross-pollination with the neighbor's garden can get farmers sued. Monsanto even used to have what was commonly called Monsanto Police, which was a group of lawyers that sued hundreds of farmers in the US. So today, plant breeders can choose to protect their innovations under plant variety protection, under patent protection, or even both, since the two have gaps in their protection and are not mutually exclusive. There was a study that compared seed catalogs from 1903 to those of 2004, and they found that only 7% of the varieties available then remained available today. Most conventional seeds are lost, and the catalogs are now filled with commercial options that belong to companies. Farmers went from being given free seeds to having to spend a big chunk of their budgets buying the same seeds over and over again because they're sterile, inconsistent, or patent protected. So why do they subject themselves to this? Because it pays off. If they plant heirlooms, they have to be ready to deal with increasingly aggressive weeds, pests, and droughts. If they buy Monsanto's GMO seeds that resist glyphosate, they can spray the herbicide indiscriminately. Their crops won't die, and they'll end up with a more profitable and consistent yield. This is one of the reasons why countries like the US can afford to have only 2% of the population working in agriculture, eliminating starvation, creating excess, and still exporting foods to other countries, where 80% of the population works in agriculture. So, there is variety being stored, and you can always use heirlooms, or plants whose patents have expired. Nevertheless, growing seeds is becoming harder, and the most profitable and resistant seeds are now owned by a handful of corporations. If I had to sum it up the challenge in one sentence, it would be this.
You realize that extinction is really not about the last individual dying, it's about a species losing the ability to evolve.
And now, regarding value. Are seeds becoming more valuable? The control over seeds is a story of power. Seeds provide not only what we eat, but also what we wear, what we drink, what farm animals eat, what we use for transportation, energy, what we smoke, you get the point. And value is a matter of supply and demand. This is an actual quote from a Monsanto representative.
One of Monsanto executives said that this is not just the consolidation of the seed sector, this is the consolidation of the entire food chain.
And if a set of companies controls the supply, they control the price. The best parallel is the diamond industry, where by reducing the market supply, they manage to inflate to absurd numbers the price of these small rocks. So, are seed prices increasing? Well, that's a tricky question. I can tell you yes, that the price of the seeds is increasing, and go cherry pick some data that proves my point. But that wouldn't make it justice, because price is not the best measurement of value. Here's a few examples that apply to the value of seeds. If a farmer pays twice as much for a seed, but gets four times the yield, is the price increase relevant? What if a farmer pays half the price but can't reuse the seeds? What if a farmer pays 100% more, but ends up saving 100% of the crop, due to resistance to a specific pest? One element that I believe shows how valuable seeds are becoming is that most seed sales in the US are no longer a commodity purchase. They are contract-based. Farmers who choose to plant GMO seeds or protected hybrids get heavily controlled via contracts or are bound by royalty-based models. It's almost like a subscription model, where farmers buy the same seeds every year. And if the seed market wasn't valuable, companies wouldn't have wasted $2 billion on lobbying over the last 20 years just in the US. Years and years of mergers and acquisitions made it so that in 2019, the three largest seed companies accounted for more than 60% of the sale of seeds worldwide. But at least these companies are competing amongst themselves, right? Well, they should be. But what if they hinder their own innovation in order to promote their profitable products? Like, I don't know, trying to keep the same herbicide in the market for over 50 years because it gives them $10 billion in yearly revenue, even though it might cause cancer, destroy the soil, and kill the pollinators. And why don't their competitors react to it? Well, because their owners are the same. They are investor companies, like BlackRock, Fidelity Group, Capital Group, and other institutional asset managers. It's called common ownership, and it gives them total market control. This is especially problematic for small farmers in developing countries. Farmers know that if they allow these companies to disrupt them, they'll become low-pay, high-labor workers on their own land. Companies call it market penetration, farmers call it slavery through debt and dependency. So coming back to the quote that opened this discussion, seeds are probably not going to become the next currency. They fare poorly in several factors and they are hard to carry and to trade, but they are one of the most precious resources on Earth, and that's why there is a full-on war over their ownership. And companies will continue to do what companies do. They'll try to increase profits, power, market share. And in a way, that's good. It gave us innovation, abundance, prosperity, but at the same time, we need to keep these companies, these behemoths in check, so that they don't consume us and the planet in the process. To give you a little bit of hope, there are some people and some organizations fighting on our behalf. And thanks to them, patents overseas expire after 20 years. Most countries have public plant breeding programs designed for public good. Some governments are helping farmers fight back and maintain their native crops. And heirlooms are now starting to boom again because more people are eating organic and supporting their local farmers. Remember that your voice is your vote. And that your vote is not only what you cast on the ballot. It's also what you put your money on. It's what you choose to consume. It's what you talk about. It's what you choose to share. My name's Mario, and thanks for watching.